Hello, everyone. My name's Kai. I'm a graduate student in the UN Zhao Group at UC San Diego, and today I'll be your host for this installment of the Polariton Chemistry webinar series. For those of you who are joining us for the first time, we have a Facebook page called Polariton Chemistry Online Community, where you can find updates about the upcoming webinars. And this page also serves as a forum for people in the community to discuss new ideas and recent findings in the field. We also have a YouTube channel where we upload recordings of each of the webinars. Here you can go and watch a webinar that you were unable to attend, or if you want, you can go and just rewatch your favorite webinars. Before I go over the mechanics of attendee participation, I'd like to make an announcement. So over the past year, we've been trying to our best to hold a session weekly. Now, as the world is trying to its best to return to normalcy, we will be, as we make transition to the organizers, we'd like to, now as the world is trying its best to return to normalcy, we'll be holding webinars monthly. As we make this transition, we, the organizers, would like to thank all the wonderful past, present, speakers and attendees for support and participation. Without all of you, this webinar series would not be possible. As for the mechanics of today's webinar, as a reminder, you may use the raise hand option to ask a verbal question. When you use this option, I'll be notified, and I will notify the speaker at the earliest convenience and unmute your mic so you can ask your question. You may write out your questions using the Q&A option, also found at the bottom of your screen. Due to the time constraints of this webinar, these questions will be addressed at the end. And with that, I'm honored to introduce today's speaker. Professor Pavlos Lagodakis received his PhD in physics from the University of Southampton in 2003. And conducted his postdoctoral research on optoelectronic properties of organic semiconductors at the Ludwig Maximilian University of Munich. In 2006, he returned to Southampton as a lecturer at the Department of Physics and Astronomy, where he combined his expertise in inorganic and organic semiconductors and set up a new experimental group on hybrid photonics. From 2011 to 2014, he chaired the university's Nanoscience Research Strategy Group, an interdisciplinary research group of approximately 100 academics across physics, chemistry, maths, engineering, biology, and medicine. From 2013 to 2019, he was the deputy head of school for research at the Department of Physics and Astronomy at the University of Southampton. At Skoltek, he designed and set up, now consults, the hybrid photonics group with focus on hybrid LEDs, PVs, and spin optronics. Professor Lagodakis has received numerous awards, including the Quantum Electrics Young Scientist Prize from the International Union of Pure and Applied Physics. His research spans the fields of photonics, strong light matter couplings, semiconductors, and condensed matter physics, and he has pioneered in the field of polaritonics with the first demonstration of polariton lasing at room temperature. Without further ado, Professor, the screen is yours.
Thank you very much. And thank you for the introduction. If you can allow me to share my screen.
Mm-hmm. You should be able to.
Mm-hmm. Let me try again. Yes, now it works. All right. So. Let's see if this will work. Okay, so you can see my...
Yeah, we can see your slides. Great.
You can see my slides in presentation
mode. In presentation mode as well, yes.
Great, thank you very much. So thank you for the introduction. It is a pleasure to join your community today and talk about our recent work on polaritons at room temperature, where we have configured them really for targeting applications in computing, including, as I will be talking about today, full logic with Polaricons. So the work that I will present here today is part of collaboration between the University of Southampton and Skoltek, a new university in Moscow, which started in the early 2010. And in 2016, we practically started there. You can see here some images from August 2016 when we just got inside the lab. And we really set up to work in advanced spectroscopies of both organic and inorganic semiconductors. However, we are not working alone. We have a very strong network of collaborators across the world with whom we design, fabricate, and study both organic and inorganic semiconductor microcavities, liquid crystal microcavities, etc. But really, the focus is on photonics, cavities, and the physics of semiconductors in cavities. So for those who are not familiar, or from a bird's eye view, if you would like, polariton is like liquid light. You hybridize light and matter, and therefore you bridge together the field of photonics and electronics. And what we have been targeting for the last 5 years in our group is applications on liquid light computing. So this is, if you like, reviving optical computing, but now using polaritons, light matter particles, instead of just using photons. So optical computing has applications on digital logic, and this would be applications as coprocessors. We will discuss later issues of scalability and what would be the usability, but also on analog computing as simulators or optimizers, which is the subject of a different talk. I will not have time today to talk about this. So we will focus on digital logic with polaritons. I will give a very brief introduction on what is a polariton for those who may join your webinar for the first time today. So practically, a polariton is formed when energy is exchanged very quickly between a photon in a cavity and an electronic transition, what we call an exciton, an optical dipole inside the cavity. And when this exchange of energy is very quick, then when the exchange of energy is quicker than any dissipation inside the system, polaritons are formed. So it's like when you couple two pendulums and new modes appear. And here you can see in reflectivity, the first demonstration of strong coupling in an inorganic microcavity back in 1992, almost 30 years ago. So the cavity here confines photons. We have a semiconductor that absorbs and emits photons, and through this rapid exchange we form polaritons. So if we go in a bit more detail, usually our structures consist of two distributed Bragg reflectors. These are very high reflectivity mirrors that consist of alternating layers of a material of two different materials with different refractive index. So by putting these two mirrors together, we are making a cavity which has a very high Q factor. And you can see here the reflectivity as a function of wavelength. So really within the stop band, the reflectivity approaches 100%. Now we can access different in-plane momenta of the photon inside the field just by changing the angle at which we are exciting or we are detecting light from the cavity. And now if we embed inside the cavity a semiconductor, and that would be a quantum well or an organic semiconductor, as we'll be talking here today, then the photon couples with the optical transition, the optical dipole, and we'll be calling those excitons, electron hole pairs. And when the exchange of energy between a photon and an exciton exceeds both the photon decay and the exciton decay, so when omega, the interaction energy, is larger than any dissipation inside the system, then we enter the strong coupling regime. And if I look at the reflectivity from such structure, instead of just looking now at the cavity mode, I will see two modes, the new normal modes of the system, which I will be calling the upper and lower polariton mode. So polariton is therefore nothing else, but if you like the mixture of a photon and an exciton, and these coefficients here, they are the so-called Hopfield coefficients that they give us from the photon part, very low effective mass. So this allows for polaritons to behave as very good bosons that condense, they form Bose-Einstein condensates at elevated temperatures all the way to room temperature, and at the same time, very short lifetimes. And from the exciton part, we get strong excitonic interactions. And in the case of excitons in inorganic semiconductors, predominantly, we also get polariton-polariton interactions. So if I take now these two constituent parts and I diagonalize this Hamiltonian, where I have the bare exciton and the bare photon energy with the interaction between the exciton and the photon, I get two new modes, as I already said. So I have the exciton and the photon in resonance, I will get the lower and the upper polariton mode. And now if I look and at the different in-plane momenta inside the system, I have new dispersions. So at zero angle, I have the upper and the lower polariton mode, which are these modes that I plotted here on the left. But for different angles, the cavity mode is has a parabolic dispersion, and therefore the splitting that I observe is changing, giving rise to this lower polariton and upper polariton dispersion. So this is how it would look if you look for photoluminescence, or if you look reflectivity from the sample as a function of angle. And of course, you can change the angle in two directions. So here I have taken a cross-section in one direction, but really you can imagine that this is a paraboloid, yes? The lower polariton dispersion and the upper polariton dispersion. So it is a two-dimensional dispersion, if you like. Now, polaritons are very good bosons. So they're constituent bosons. The exciton, it is an electron hole pair, but the sum of the spins of the electron in the hole is intense. So the excitons behave as bosons. The photons are bosons, of course. If you mix these two, you make a boson which is very light. And Bose-Einstein condensation of exciton polaritons was for the first time observed in 2006 in the group of Benoit, Devoux, and Le Sidank. And a Bose-Einstein condensate of polaritons, it gives you direct access to the properties of the condensate through photoluminescence. So just by looking at what comes out of the sample, polaritons transform to photons, leak out as photons, and they carry with them the energy, the momentum, the spin, and the phase of the condensed system inside the cavity. And here you can see the dispersion, photoluminescence from the dispersion, where as you increase the power, at some point you hit a threshold power at which you form a condensate, a polariton condensate. So you see a collapse of the wave function of the ground state of the polariton dispersion. The year after 2006 in Southampton, we managed to observe polariton lasing, and I will be interchanging between polariton lasing and polariton condensates. I will not go into the detail of the difference. At room temperature, using a gallium nitride semiconductor microcavity, which allows for excitons to survive at room temperature. And later on, there was a first demonstration of an electrically pumped polariton laser. So this is a system which is based on semiconductor technology, and it offers the flexibility to generate this kind of exotic state of matter through electrical injection. And a year later, in organic semiconductor microcavities, in Nature Materials, the group of Stefan Kenna-Cohen and Rainer Mart from IBM, so Imperial and IBM, they observed for the first time in organic semiconductors Bose-Einstein condensates. So there is a difference for those who come from laser physics. There is a difference between a polariton and the photon laser. So you should not be confused from the fact that you get coherent emission coming out from both of them. In the case of a photon laser, you inject carriers non-resonantly. You have spontaneous cooling of the carriers at the bottom of the exciton dispersion. And then through stimulated emission of photons, you get, when you reach population inversion, you get a laser. And the ground state of the system, if you like, is the crystal ground state. So coherent light from a laser. In the case of an exciton polariton BEC, again, you inject carriers non-resonantly, they spontaneously cool, they cool initially to the ground state, and when we reach occupancy of one at the ground state of the polariton dispersion, not the crystal ground state, then we get stimulated cooling of polaritons, and we form a macroscopic wave function, a Bose-Einstein condensate of polaritons at the ground polariton state. And what we observe is the polaritons that leak out through the finite cavity lifetime from the structure. So very different beasts, if you like, and we will be here talking about exciton polariton Bose-Einstein condensates in organic semiconductors. So since the first observations of polariton condensation in different type of materials. A lot of work has happened both with inorganic materials of large dielectric and small dielectric constants, inorganic materials, which are amorphous or crystalline semiconductors, and each of the different material platforms has its benefits, but also some drawbacks. For example, when we are working in our group with inorganic semiconductors, we have very high finesse structures, low disorder, but extremely challenging fabrication methods. It can take us up to 5 years to make just one sample in which we can study the kind of systems that we are working with, extended polarity and lattice in inorganic microcavities. When it comes to organic semiconductors, they have very high oscillator strength. They're extremely emissive. You can see the light coming out of the condensate with your bare eye. They can operate at room temperature, and they have less challenging fabrication methods. So really, with our co-workers, we can really fabricate a lot of working samples within a reasonable time. You know, within a year, you can get very high quality organic microcavities. However, organic semiconductors, they are hampered by spatial disorder and in some cases, photobleaching. So if you like, the quest for the ideal material still continues, and a lot of talks have taken place in this webinar about TMDCs and other type of materials put inside cavities or in open cavity configurations. So the ideal material that would allow you to have room temperature operation and work with extended lattices and you would not have photobleaching still carries on. But here I have put together a list, if you like, of different organic materials that have been studied so far. And there is a huge gamut within even the organic microcavities, starting from dye-dispersed organics in microcavities, polymers, organic crystals, fluorescent proteins, J-aggregates. I have to say that actually the very first demonstration of strong coupling in organic microcavities, it was carried out by David Lijay and Professor Donald Bradley back in 1998, with the first demonstration of polarity lasing in such structures being done only 10 years later. So what are the applications of polaritons? Well, there are plenty, and a lot have been discussed in your series here. Today, I will be talking about polariton computing. And what I will try to show you is that we can actually do full logic with polariton transistors. So there's a very nice paper back from 2010 by David Miller, who is really, if you like, advocates about optical transistors as the logical next step to really be able to increase the speed of our transistors beyond the 5 gigahertz of our electronic transistors. And a lot of work has happened in polaritonics in between. So when you want to make a transistor, you need to have amplification, first of all. And the first polariton amplifier under resonant excitation condition was demonstrated at Southampton by my good friend Pablo Savvidis and his supervisor Jeremy Baumberg at cryogenic temperatures in inorganic microcavity. So that was the first demonstration of amplification using polaritons. Later on in 2013, the group of Daniele Sandito showed how you can engineer this kind of polariton condensates to make an all optical polariton transistor in an inorganic microcavity working again at cryogenic temperatures. And it was not until 2017 that in a very nice review, David Snoke and Jonathan Keeling, they were discussing the potential of organic polaritonics, and they said that actually parametric scattering remains elusive years after the first observation of condensation of organic polaritons and optical amplification as well. In collaboration with IBM, we set out to see what are the reasons why actually both parametric scattering and amplification was so far elusive. And before I go into the details of the structure that we studied, just to give you a brief introduction on the dynamics of relaxation, of energy relaxation towards the ground polariton state in microcavities. Usually we inject carriers incoherently at a high energy that can be optically in organics and microcavities or even electrically in inorganic microcavities. And then we have a relaxation of the electron hole plasma that we inject down to the exciton reservoir, which is cooling down spontaneously by the emission of phonons. And then eventually it reaches the ground Pollardion state. When we reach the ground Pollardion state and we bring occupancy of one due to stimulated relaxation, Pollardions and bosons, so they obey Bose-Einstein statistics, all Pollardions then scatter, dissipate energy with whatever way they can find, and they relax to the ground Pollardion state, forming the condensate. So the relaxation is usually done through phonons or vibrons in organic semiconductors. And actually back in 2010, we studied the role of phonon-mediated energy relaxation in crystalline semiconductors. And by tuning the resonance of the lower polariton mode by controlling the detuning between the exciton and the photon resonance, we could see that actually the strongest emission comes when we were hitting and longitudinal optical phonon resonance between the pumping and the ground polariton state. So we were-
Excuse me, Professor?
Yes.
We have a question.
Yes.
Go ahead, Argandeep.
Yeah, hello, can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah, so my question is about this Bose-Einstein condensate that you showed. So is it like the real Bose-Einstein condensate which you have in bosons? In the sense the entire thing is described by one wave function. I mean, the thing I am concerned about is what allows for this polariton condensation to happen at a finite room temperature, whereas the Bose-Einstein, the usual Bose-Einstein condensation requires very low temperatures to be formed. So I mean, what advantage?
Thank you for your question. So in the case of atomic condensates, I think this is what you have in your mind, and the first demonstration of an atomic Bose-Einstein condensate, the temperatures that were required were microkelvin. And the reason is that the critical temperature for condensation scales with the mass. So atoms are very heavy particles, and therefore you need scales inversely with the mass. So you need to cool down the system very much in order to reach this critical condensation temperature. In the case of a polariton, because you have a quasi-particle which is mixed with light, it is thousands of, it's 10,000 times higher, the lower the mass than, the mass of even an exciton in an atom. So the temperature for condensation can really exceed even room temperature. So there are a lot of studies with different materials that have strong excitons that survive even above room temperature, and polariton condensation has been observed there. Now, if you look at it from a mathematical point of view, this is an open dissipative system. So in the case of, if you take quantum statistics, you would like to have a closed system inside which you will form your condensate. But the physics and the physics for open dissipative systems has been studied now for more than 20 years. And if we were to talk more rigorously, we would need to talk about Berezinski-Kosterly Thouless transition, the formation of a superfluid. But I'm afraid I will not have time to go into the difference, if you like, of the different type of superfluids and condensates that are formed. If you are interested, we can carry on the discussion later, and we can meet one-to-one, and we can discuss the literature and really the physics involved. But the reason behind your question is that polaritons are much, much lighter than atoms, and that's why the condensation threshold is much higher in temperature.
I see. Okay, so these are real condensates in the sense entire thing is described by one wave function, right? That's what you...
Absolutely. It is one wave function, and they behave as superfluids.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you for your question. So if there are no more questions right now, what I was saying here is that what we found back in 2010 is that the relaxation of carriers that we inject non-resonantly at the ground polariton state is more efficient if we hit a resonance with a phonon mode, that's the equivalent of a vibron in organic semiconductors, for those who come from organic semiconductors. And actually, even the condensation threshold minimizes when you hit this phonon resonance. So the same concept applies also in organic semiconductors, as I will show you, but there are also other processes for energy relaxation. And if we focus here in organics, we have interparticle polariton scattering, so two polariton scattering together. This is a very efficient process in inorganic semiconductors where we deal with delocalized excitons. However, in organic semiconductors, we usually work with localized excitons, and therefore each exciton is sitting at a different molecule, and this per polariton scattering is almost absent, and our studies have shown that. Now there is another way of populating the ground polariton state, and this is through intracavity pumping. So practically what happens is that not all your molecules are strongly coupled, and some molecules within the cavity emit resonantly with the ground polariton state. So you can have intracavity pumping of the low polariton dispersion, and this is a quite efficient process that led in the demonstration of polariton lasing back in 2010 in crystalline semiconductors. And of course, there will be these vibrons that I've been talking about. And these vibrons in organic semiconductors, depending on the stiffness of the molecules, they can carry very high amounts of energy. And we studied those 10 years ago, how they actually mediate the relaxation of energy in organic semiconductors. So in a collaboration with the groups of David Lidze and Pablo Savidis, we studied the process of relaxation, both as a factor of how it enhances the photoluminescence. So what you have here with the black lines, the Raman spectrum of a J aggregate molecule, and here I have drawn dust lines to show that the PL is enhanced when we hit a vibron, when we hit a resonance, a Raman mode. And also when we studied back then with a pump probe, the rise time of the photoluminescence, we saw that actually the rise time was shortest when we had when we're hitting this resonance. So it was really accelerating, if you like, the vibrons were accelerating the relaxation of polarities. However, in these structures, at that time we could not observe condensation, and we started, but IBM and the group of Rainer Mart had demonstrated in 2014 polariton condensation, very clear evidence, using a ladder type polymer called MELPPP. So this is an oligopolymer, which is like a ladder. It is very stiff, and they managed to show that they can get under non-resonant excitation polariton condensation. So we were interested to see if we can utilize the vibron modes, so the oscillation modes of these molecules, which carry huge amounts of energy, in this case, 164 and almost 200 millielectron volt, in order to optimize the relaxation process and reduce the condensation threshold. So schematically on the polariton dispersion, we tune the system so that we can pump hot excitons exactly one vibron, yeah, if you like 200 MeV, above the ground polariton state. And what we observed is that we can form a condensate under such conditions. So we pump quasi-resonantly, if you like, one vibron above the ground polariton state. And the threshold for condensation was reduced by more than a factor of 10 with respect to the condensation threshold that had been observed previously in these structures, where they were pumping at above 3 electron volt, just an electron hole plasma. So we did a full dependence here to see the characteristics of condensation in the nonlinear features of the photoluminescence. So we see that when we hit threshold, the emission from the ground state is increased dramatically. At threshold, we have a reduction of the line width. So we form a macroscopic wave function, which has high coherence across the state. And we observe a very rigid blue shift, which at the time was understood as an evidence of polariton condensation. And therefore the superlinear photoluminescence, the strong line with narrowing and the energy shift really are the key signatures that you have brought now your strongly coupled cavity into the strong coupling regime, into polariton laser. And the threshold under such conditions actually was dramatically lower than what we had observed with different material systems, or other colleagues around the world had observed. You know, we had worked with BodyPi, where we needed 120 microjoule per square centimeter to get condensation threshold, where now we could get it for 8 microjoule of absorbed power.
Professor, we have another question.
Yes, of course.
Go ahead, Joel.
Hello. I have a question about this vibronically induced relaxation. Yes. Because calculations show, so the radiative pumping mechanism is relatively clear in my opinion, but the vibronic one is quite still a mystery because the vibrations that induce this relaxation are local. They are basically local in each of the molecules, whereas the polaritons are delocalized. So then in principle, these relaxation processes scale as 1/n, where n is the number of molecules per photon mode, which is gigantic. So I guess the question I have is, can you tell me what is, so in the studies that you carried out, is this for J aggregates or for what type of systems?
Well, this we studied both for J aggregates and for, so in the case of MLPPP, this oligopolymer, we also observed the same thing. And I have at the end of the presentation, I have some slides where I can show you data where practically we scan the excitation across the vibrant resonance, and you see that when you hit the vibrant resonance, the photoluminescence from the ground polariton state is enhanced very much, or we fix the excitation and we change the detuning. And when we bring the ground polariton state with resonance with the vibron, again, the threshold for condensation is reduced dramatically. And the reason I understand, just to answer your question, is that what we are enabling to relax is the exciton which is sitting in one molecule. So depending on what is your Frohlich constant, you take an exciton and you bring it directly to a polariton mode. You are right that the process would not be potentially as efficient if we were talking about polaritons on the higher wave vectors of the polariton dispersion, yeah, because polaritons are much more delocalized. But the excitons in the exciton reservoir, the excitons that sit in individual molecules, they interact very strongly with these vibronic modes. And that is really the origin behind that very efficient energy relaxation when we hit this resonance.
Sure.
At the end of the presentation, I can actually, I will bring this data and discuss it further if you wish.
Okay, so let me just follow up with a very quick question. So then, is there no way this relaxation is really a version of just radiative pumping?
No, because if it was radiative pumping, we would be looking where you pump would be relevant with where you pump, as long as you pump, of course, non-resonantly, it would be relevant with the energy of with this enhancement that we see. So indeed, if you only change the detuning, radiative pumping, you can hit resonance and then it can enhance the relaxation, if you like, or the population of the lower polariton mode. But we have seen this effect in both dependencies. The one dependence is where you leave, if you like, the ground polariton state at a fixed energy, and then you scan the pump, which is always non-resonant. And when you hit a vibron, that's when we see the enhancement. In the other way around, we leave again the pump non-resonant, and then when we scan, we see that actually the biggest enhancement we have when we hit a vibron. The process that you refer to is present, but in our case, it is not the most efficient present because we are dealing with a very thin layer of an organic, which it is not that the whole cavity is filled and we have a lot of uncoupled molecules. Most of the molecules in our structure are strongly coupled.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
You may continue, Professor.
Thank you. So, yes. So then I wanted to say a few words about this blue shift, the energy shift that we observe when we hit condensation threshold. So here I have, I'm putting data of, you can see here on the top left panel, the photoluminescence from the lower polariton dispersion in a case of a dye-filled microcavity. And as we increase excitation density at some point, you see the collapse of the photoluminescence at the ground polariton state. And if I look at the intensity with a black line here, indeed, when I hit threshold, I have a nonlinear increase of the photoluminescence intensity. I have a collapse of the line width, which means that coherence forms inside my system. And when I look at the energy of the mode, I see that I have a very clear blue shift of the lower polariton mode. And at the same time, we also have a buildup of degree of linear polarization. In this case, we are dealing with dye molecules. When you pump, practically you have optical alignment. You pump predominantly the molecules which are aligned parallel with the polarization, the linear polarization of your pump. And therefore, when these molecules will contribute stronger in the formation of the condensate, and the condensate will be linear polarized, carrying the polarization of the non-resonant pump, not the coherence of the pump. But when we looked into what are the reasons for this blue shift in organic microcavities, and here I need to say briefly that in the case of inorganic microcavities, you have excitons that move in the crystal, they repel each other, and therefore the more excitons you put, the bigger the blue shift, if you like, you renormalize your lower polarity dispersion. But in the case of organics, either the polymer that I was discussing before or the dye molecules here, the excitons sit in individual molecules. They don't see each other. So this exciton-exciton or polariton-polariton scattering, if you like, is very much quenched. So we did here, practically we don't have interparticle Coulomb exchange interactions in the system. So what we did a study where we looked at the potential mechanisms that can be responsible in organic microcavities. So we looked at the intracavity Kerr effect. We looked at the gain-induced frequency pooling. Gain-induced frequency pooling is if your gain is actually blue detuned from where you form, if you like, from where the ground polariton state is, you will have gain pooling towards the highest gain inside the system, and that would give you a blue shift. But again, we could exclude this mechanism because no matter where we would tune the ground polariton state to be, on the red or the blue side of the maximum gain, we would always see a blue shift. We could exclude polariton-polariton interactions through some nonlinear studies that we saw. So the shifts that we saw were not following this kind of quadratic dependence. And then we also studied the interplay of weakly and strongly coupled molecules and intermolecular energy transfer. And practically, after having exhausted all the different type of dependencies, we concluded that the blue shift in organic microcavities, it comes predominantly by a quenching of the Rabi splitting. So the more molecules you excite, the less is the absorption in your system, and that quenches the Rabi splitting, but also from a cavity shift due to a change of the refractive index. And this is a mechanism that had been neglected so far. And when we looked at the contribution of this mechanism, so the, if you like, the normalization of the refractive index because you put more and more caries inside the system. So if I plot here as rho, the energy shift that we get from the cavity, so from the refractive index normalization, so from the cavity shift with respect to the Rabi splitting, we see that the strongest contribution comes from this change of refractive index. So the physics of blue shift in organic microcavities is very different to the physics of blue shift in inorganic microcavities. And therefore, one should not be confused. You know, when you work in the two different fields, the conclusions that are drawn from blue shifts in inorganics do not apply in the case of organics and vice versa. So if you are interested to look into this study, it's a comprehensive study that appeared actually last year, where we did a very extensive study, including a Z-scan, et cetera, et cetera. Okay, so now that we discussed about the polariton condensation, the physics of the blue shift in polariton condensation in organic microcavities, then we looked if we can really use the process, the non-linearity, if you like, in the formation of the condensate, and seed the condensate with a control beam, with a probe beam for those who do pump probe, at the ground polariton state. So we tuned the system again in order to bring it in resonance with the Vibron, and we put a seed beam at the ground polariton state, and then we look at seeded polariton condensation. The concept of condensate does not quite apply here, but practically we see we look at the amplification of the seed beam due to the stimulated relaxation of polaritons from the hot exciton reservoir. And when we do the when we look at the dispersion, so here you see the formation of a condensate when we have the pump only in the system, and when we bring the seed beam at the ground polariton state, we see that actually the emission is concentrated exactly at the states that we see. So it is like dynamic condensation, which leads to a reduction in the threshold. So here with the pump, you have only the non-resonant pump. With the red, you have the pump plus the control beam. And we see that we can shift, we can reduce the threshold by a factor of 2 than what we would have with the pump only. We have 50 times rise in the relaxation, the condensation efficiency, plus it is a system which allows you to get, if you like, a condensate, a coherent state, macroscopically occupied on demand. So the other thing that we observed in this system where we is that we can actually, this process is extremely fast. So we can switch it on within and it survives just for something like 400 picoseconds. So we can go from 0 to 1 within 400 picoseconds. So it's an ultra fast switch, if you like. And of course, now you can look at it as an amplifier. So it is a polarity amplifier. You put a small signal in and you get a much bigger signal out. And you can see here, the amplified signal is much, much stronger than what we would get just with the pump. The pump here is multiplied by a factor of 200. It is so much smaller. And if we do the full dependence and you look at the signal amplification or the net gain as a function of the fluence, we see that actually as we reduce the fluence, we get to very, very high amplification of the seed pulse. So we have a record net gain of 10 decibel per micrometer here. The process does not require phase matching. So this kind of amplification process now does not require the phase matching conditions which were imposed in inorganic microcavities where you had to pump resonantly with a polariton dispersion at the inflection point and send the seed beam at the ground state and match energy and momentum. No phase matching required here because we pump non-resonantly and it operates at ambient conditions. So we really have an amplifier that works at ambient conditions. And if you look at the net gain of this system, it is actually quite impressive. So we get net gain, which exceeds actually that from many other nonlinear optical systems. It is of course in a cavity, but we get dramatic amplification of the seed pulse. And now the question is, how small can I make my seed pulse? And actually what you see here is that what we have done, we are reducing the energy of the seed pulse and we look at the contrast of the emission with and without the seed. And on the bottom axis, you see the number of photons that we put inside the system. And you see that actually we have a substantial contrast that approaches one autojoule. So very small switching energy and very few photons needed in order to switch the condensate on or to get the amplification process working. And we did the
Professor, we have another question.
Yes, of course.
Go ahead, Donald.
Sorry. Hi, Pavlos. It's Donald Bradley here. So I was interested to know at what wavelength you were getting your amplification and whether the Rabi splitting energy controls the range that the amplification can occur over.
Yes. So in this structure, this is the MELPPP organic. So we get the amplification at in the blue. So we work from 480, 490, and it is tunable with the detuning. So we can get actually amplification for a very long range of detunings. So we can span more than 30 nanometers in the blue, depending what detuning we are choosing.
So does it also then depend on the seed pump wavelength?
Of course, the seed pump, the seed wavelength is always resonant with the ground polariton state in what I present here, and the pump is non-resonant. So we fix the seed at the ground polariton state and we see that the seed is being amplified. And does this answer your question?
Yeah, I'm just trying to think. So if you wanted to take this out to optical communication wavelengths, what would you need to do?
You would need to work with a system where practically your ground polariton state is in that range of the spectrum. And there are actually works with vibrant polaritons that aim in this direction. It goes beyond the concept of the talk here, but if your polaritons, if you have vibrant polaritons, which are in the near infrared and in the optical communication window, then potentially the processes that we study here could apply. We have not attempted, but we have played for different wavelengths within the visible. So we can go from the blue all the way to the red so far.
Thank you. Thanks, Pavlos.
You're very welcome. And thank you, Donald. So really here, the point that I was making is that actually, eventually, we can just send one photon and we can amplify this one photon. So this is a single photon switch. And I'm not showing the results here, but stay tuned. In a couple of months, the paper will appear. It has been accepted, where we demonstrate that we can do single photon switching using this process that I'm describing here. Now, if you really are looking into this optical transistor concept that David Miller was advocating, you also need to show that you can cascade your amplification process. And this is what we set out to do here. So we had one pump and one control beam, and we got amplification of the control beam, which you can see here in 3D or here in a color map at the bottom left. And then we took out the emission of the sample and we brought it at a different position when there was a second pump waiting to amplify the signal even further. So we could see that we can do cascaded amplification in this structure. It is, so the way that it works is practically you take the light out of the sample and you bring it back somewhere else where another pump waits to reamplify your signal. And then if you have amplification, cascaded amplification, ultra-fast switching and a good extinction ratio, and you can see here the extinction ratio as a function of the excitation density, we approach 17 dB, practically you have a transistor. This is a null optical transistor that operates at room temperature. And once you build your first optical transistor, polariton transistor, what you do then is to go on and put few of them together in order to make logic gates. And this is what we did. So we engineered, if you like, a system where we have we configured the OR gate with using three different condensates, or three different, if you like, transistors. And you can see here the characteristics of the output in the truth table of the OR gate. We configured the NOR gate as well, and then after having configured the OR and the AND gate, we were very happy that we can do logic, but actually you cannot do full logic with OR and AND gates, no matter how you combine them. And this was actually brought up by David Snoke, who wrote a News and Views for our paper on the first organic polariton logic gate, saying that actually this is not applicable for full logic yet, because there is no equivalent of the NOT gate, of the negation gate. Because what he says here, it is very difficult to switch off an optical signal with another optical signal. And that was a challenge at the time, and it really set out for us the search for a universal gate. So really, if you want to have full logic, you need to be able to combine your OR and AND gates with a negation, with a NOT gate. And there are two universal gates which allow you to do full logic, the NOR and the NAND gate. The NAND gate is what we have in our electronics and in our phones today. The NOR gate is an alternative which is lesser used in electronics. So we looked into the potential of really configuring the system as the getting the negation or the universal gate. And for that, we configured it slightly differently. We tuned the vibron so that it is resonant not with a ground polariton state, but with a polariton state which comes at an angle slightly higher in energy from the polariton condensate. And then we sent the seed pulse resonant with this mode here. And what we observed is actually that we can get this kind of amplification process that we showed before, now with the seed being not at the ground state. So non-ground state, if you like, dynamic condensation, where we have the nonlinear increase of the photoluminescence, the collapse of the line width, the blue shift that we described before. So practically, if you manage to do this and you have a pump which creates a condensate at the ground state, and then you come with a seed which is away from the ground state and you switch off the condensation of the ground state and you bring it at a non-ground state, when you look at the emission from normal incidence from the sample, from where the ground state condensation would occur, what you engineer is the NOT gate. So in the absence of the seed, you have the output, and in the presence of the seed that brings the condensate at a different in-plane wave vector, different angle, it switches off your emission from normal incidence. So this is the NOT gate, and you can see here how the emission is extinct when we increase the seed power. So if you have your NOT gate, it is actually a quite flexible system now, the polariton transistor, in order to make the NOR gate. All you need to do, if you want a two-input NOR gate, is practically to bring, so here you can see, for example, the truth table for the polariton NOR gate. In the absence of any input, you get the polariton condensate. When you bring one input to the left here, the condensate moves all of it to the left. When you have an input on the right, in the opposite wave vector, then you get the condensate switching off again, and all the emission comes there. And in the presence of both input channels in the NOR gate, practically, you get the condensate at these two opposite in-plane wave vectors, and again, you switch off your condensate at normal incidence, which means that practically what we have engineered here is the truth table of the NOR gate, which is a universal gate and which allows for full logic. And some of you will notice that actually the emission of the condensate with respect to the seeded condensate, the non-ground seeded condensate, there is an energy difference, which means that when it comes to cascadability, it would be difficult in the system to use the output of one NOR gate as the input to another NOR gate. And to correct this issue, what we did, we used the process of reamplification, if you like, as a rectifier. So we do frequency rectification just by taking the emission of the condensate and reamplifying it. And when we do that, practically we start with the condensate, which is the blue line, and through rectification, it really comes and it's pretty much resonant with the input, with the output of the system from the non-ground state condensate. So we can now match, if you like, the inputs and the outputs, which allows you to now cascade different logic gates. And the polariton dispersion being so rich, I have been showing to you the polariton dispersion in one dimension. So let's say at one angle, as I change one angle against the sample, but of course I can change in the orthogonal direction. So what I have is a parabolic dispersion. So what you can do therefore, without needing to combine different transistors, just at the same position, you can now utilize the two-dimensional character of the polariton dispersion and bring more than two inputs. So you can have a multi-input NOR gate. So what you see here is in a KX, KY reciprocal image, if you like, of the polariton condensate forming in the presence of the non-resonant pump when we do not seed. And then I show you here that we can put more than two seeds. We can put more than two inputs. So here I show you an image of five, and we can go to a larger number than that now. And when this is the seed by themselves in the absence of the pump, and when I have the pump and the seeds, what I see is that I quench the emission in the center and all the emission comes nicely where the seeds are. So I can fabricate within the same transistor a multi-input NOR gate. This is actually, if you look for multi-input NOR gates in electronics, the circuitry becomes quite complicated, yes? You really need to add together several transistors in order to obtain that. We're here within the same system, we can obtain that. And I know that I have exceeded my time. So at this point, I will conclude by thanking, of course, the heroes in the lab who made this happen. So Anton Zasedatelev for the single photon switch, and a huge contribution in our work in organic semiconductors, and Anton Baranikov, who worked with Anton Zasadatelev on the Polaridon transistor, and other core workers who have been working both at the University of Southampton and Skoltek. I can tell you that, you know, COVID, no COVID, I'm traveling now every 2 weeks back and forth. I spent 2 weeks in one place, 2 weeks in the other. And of course, our colleagues from IBM for the design and the fabrication of the sample. And of course, David Lidze, with whom we have been working for a very long time on the dye field microcavities from the University of Sheffield. Our founder, CPSRC, and the Grecorassian project and some MIT Skoltek project, and all of you for your attention.
Thank you, Professor. So now we're open for a couple more questions. So go ahead, Hoel.
Thank you for a very nice talk. So I have a very naive question first. So I have two questions, but the first one might be a bit naive. So can you please explain what is uniquely polaritonic about these gates? So if I just use lasers, could I achieve, for example, the NOT gate that you described? I believe you can also do it with a laser, right?
Are you talking about a laser in a nonlinear media?
Yeah, so like a dye laser. So without, so if I don't show strong coupling, but then I just have like cavity with organic dyes, could I not get the same phenomenon that you are describing?
Well, if you are operating in the weak coupling regime, let's say, yes. So practically, you just have a dye, you fill a cavity with an organic semiconductor, but now you are operating in the weak coupling regime. You have this vibronic process that I'm describing, for example. It is not as dominant there. You rely on the intracavity pumping. So you are dealing with different, if you like, energy relaxation processes than the ones that we are dealing with. And work that has been done there shows actually much higher thresholds for amplification. Now, of course, here we have the flexibility of playing with the dispersion of the polariton. So going for the NOR gate, I need to be able to obtain amplification at different wave vectors in the plane of the cavity. And usually when we work with organic lasers, you get the lasing at the maximum gain of the system, yes?
Okay, so basically you're saying that the polariton, the most important thing here is that it adds frequency tunability.
It adds the physics where practically it is not a laser as I described initially. We are dealing with a condensate, and therefore this condensate, this amplification for forming the condensate, it is not driven by optical gain of the material, and therefore we can drive it at will at different in-plane wave vectors, which is essential for the NOT and NOR gate that I was showing. Of course, you can make an amplifier, and people have done, with just a weakly coupled
nonlinear material.
There has never been an observation of a universal gate of a NOR or a NAND gate in an organic laser in the weak coupling regime.
But fundamentally, that's not forbidden, right? Like maybe in a few years.
You could do not with a planar cavity, because again the amplification will occur at the maximum of your gain. Yes.
Yes.
And that's it. You are fixed there. Where here we can trigger it wherever we like. You could potentially make a project where you tune your structure so that it can lace in two different modes, but then you will run into issues that we have run in the past of mode competition. So there is something which is quite surprising here, that when I have two inputs in my NOR gate, I don't see a competition between the two modes. If this was just a laser, so if this was just an organic laser, if you try to drive from the same reservoir, from the same gain at two different modes, you will enter into mode competition. Here you can go up to 10 inputs and there is no mode competition. And the reason is coming really from the polariton dynamics.
I see. So the stimulated scattering, so there is no mode competition because the pumping is off resonance and the stimulated scattering is happening in the polariton.
This is one of the reasons, yes. So,
okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So, okay, and very quick follow up. So you mentioned in one of the slides that there are three types of relaxation. One of them is radiative pumping, the other one is vibronic relaxation. But then you also showed the interparticle scattering through the polariton branch. Has that been ever shown experimentally with organic dyes?
Not with organic dyes. And the reason is that in the case of organic dyes, each exciton is sitting at one dye molecule, and therefore the excitons are separated. You will have a little bit of this interaction if you have a very highly dense system, yeah? And you start also having intermolecular energy transfer. So for the excitons to see each other on nearby molecules, you really need to have a very highly dense system, which drives you into other issues. If the excitons are not sitting in one molecule, you don't have practically exchange, interparticle exchange interaction. So you switch off this polariton-polariton or exciton-exciton scattering with Frenkel excitons, which are practically excitons localized at individual molecules. If you go to crystalline organic semiconductors, then this process would be possible.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Okay. And then we have a question from Vinod.
Hi, Pavlos. Vinod Menon here.
Hi, Vinod.
Hey. I want to ask you about the lattice work that you've been doing and frame it in this context of organic molecules. So as you rightly mentioned to Hoel, the exciton-exciton interaction is not strong in these materials, and so you can't use the same idea that you have in the gallium arsenide system. But what about other forms of nonlinearity, like saturation nonlinearities and things like that? Can one use that as a way to realize lattices with these systems?
Thank you, Vinod. We are actually now working very intensely on that. So indeed, it is possible to create lattices of polariton condensates also in organic microcavities and control their interactions. I cannot say much more, but since you give me the opportunity, for those who are not familiar, what you see here is, this is not data, this is not modeling, this is actually experimental data, this is not simulation, experimental data of a lattice of polariton condensates. You can arrange your condensates in a square lattice, in a triangular lattice, in an hexagonal lattice, and we have now developed the techniques to control very accurately the position, but also the interaction and the relative density of polariton condensates. And it is unfortunately the subject of a different talk on what type of computing you can do with this. You can do analog computing, you can use these polariton lattices as simulators, and we are working both on inorganic, but now also on organic semiconductors in this direction. Just for those who are not familiar on how we obtain this kind of beautiful lattices that you saw there, we use spatial light modulators, where we have feedback from the sample in order to optimize the hologram on the spatial light modulator and really perfect the kind of polariton, macroscopic polariton wave function that you saw before. And that allows you to tune in real time the position. So here on the left, you see the pump. And here you see, of course, in the pump, there are no interferences. And here you see the polariton condensates, which being polariton, interacting polariton condensates, you can see the fringes, yes? So with a video rate, we can now modulate the position of polariton condensates. And we can study, for example, as you saw before, for the multi-input structure, real space, Fourier space. Here we can change in real time the diameter, if you like, the position in a ring on a polygon of polariton condensates. We can rotate them in real time. And of course, you will see that the Fourier space also rotates. Yes. So there is a lot of potential for Pollardion condensates, including for lattices, including lattices in organic microgravities for analog computation. So really simulation and beyond algorithmic computation. But really, this is the subject of a different talk.
Thanks, Pavlos.
Thank you, Vinny.
And then we have, I guess, a question in the chat, actually, from Siddhikanta. Very nice talk. Is this placing the polariton with respect to the Vibron resonance to achieve condensation specific to this MELPPP polymer? Is it even more important that the inner cavity pumping mechanism, placing the polariton resonant to emission maximum, and detuning, which is increasing the photonic fraction of the polariton mode, or should there be a subtle balance between them all the three of these factors to get condensation in organic materials?
Right. Thank you very much for this question. It is very interesting. Indeed, intracavity pumping is present, but actually it is the lesser of the mechanisms and not an essential here. The stronger mechanism is the Vibron. So now I have the opportunity, if you like, to show you what I promised earlier in the discussion, which was, I hope you can still see my screen.
Yeah, we can still see your screen.
Excellent. So really the role of the Vibron, all right? So here, these are the two dependencies that I was describing before for the Vibron assisted relaxation. So what we are doing here, we are fixing the pump and then we play with the detuning of the structure. And the detuning of the structure is such that we can scan both Vibrons which are present in this structure. And you will see here that the occupancy of polaritons is really increasing when we hit resonance with the Vibron, it goes down again and it goes up again on the next Vibron. And for the black dots, you have condensation. For the circles here, we cannot even get polariton condensation. So when we are very far from the Vibrons, polariton condensation actually is not even feasible in such a configuration. And then what we did, because someone could say that here, okay, you happen to scan with the Vibrons, but maybe you also scan with the fluorescence of the molecule of the uncoupled molecules. So, but then it would be monotonical. Yes, you expect to have a monotonical dependence. But to really remove any doubt that intracavity pumping is not a driving mechanism, we fix the detuning and now we change the resonance of the pump. So if you like, any contribution of intracavity pumping is there, fixed, constant. And we just change the resonance of the pump and we fix, of course, the absorption. And then what you see here is that again, the occupancy, this is a logarithmic scale on the bottom right axis, increases dramatically when again I hit this Vibron resonance, right? So the Vibron resonance is the most important mechanism for this particular oligopolymer that we are using, which has very, very strong Vibrons. And we have seen that it also plays a role in other organic materials. Now there could be some materials which are very soft, and therefore this the Frohlich constant, the exciton Vibron interaction may not be so strong, and therefore other processes such as intracavity pumping can play a bigger role. But for stiff molecules that have strong high energy Vibrons and with high Frohlich constant, then actually what we have seen, and we have also now done the theory for this, which will appear soon, this mechanism is the strongest contributor to polariton condensation.
Okay. I think that is it for questions. We have time for all the time we have for questions today. Once again, Professor, thank you for a wonderful talk. If you could allow me to share my screen, I'll just have the last few words.
Thank you very much for the opportunity.
Thank you. Thank you once again for agreeing to participate in today's session. So just one reminder before we adjourn for today. Again, we will be moving to monthly webinars. And we will be notifying you about the upcoming speaker and in the near future. And until then, everyone stay safe and enjoy the rest of your week. Thank you. Um.